Hi, friends. I'm Kim from Kim's Upholstery, and I'm here today with Christa Madison. Hi, Christa.
Hey, Kim. How are you?
Great. Christa has a business called Marsh Grass Threads, and she's located in Stratford, Connecticut. I invited Christa here today to share a little bit about her journey into the world of upholstery with you, because I always find it interesting to see where people have come from and how they've gotten to where they are today, doing upholstery or other creative things like that. So I've asked Christa to join with us and tell you a little bit about herself. So Christa, would you mind sharing a little bit of your background with our members, our viewers?
Sure. I have been sewing for over 40 years, which I hate to say, but it's been a long time. I started when I was probably in high school, and I had a high school teacher. She really took me under her wing and mentored me, and she became like my second mother while I was in high school. So she ended up that while I was in, I took her classes in high school for 3 years. And then in my last year, she allowed me to do an independent study in sewing. So what I did was I made my own quilt, and I made it all by hand. And it was a queen size. And I actually won second place in the state of Connecticut through what then was Polyfill Company. I don't know if it's still in existence or not, but so I did. I entered a contest and won second place, and I've been sewing on and off ever since. I have a career with the federal government right now, and I'm transitioning. Well, I will transition because I'm going to retire the end of the year. And then I will be focusing and concentrating on my business full time at that point. But right now it's just part time.
So you started sewing when you were young, and hand sewing a quilt from start to finish on that large of a quilt is definitely a task. I've never done that myself. I've only sewing machine sewn quilts. So what drew you from, you know, the sewing to working with the government and now to upholstery? How did you decide upholstery was right for you?
Because all along, I never knew. I always liked sewing. But when I was in school and I didn't know what I was going to do, I didn't know that like a workroom really existed. And now, since I've been exposed to you and Sandra Van Sickle and Donna Cash and all, it's amazing. Everybody kind of does this, but I just never knew what it was actually called back then. And I mean, I've always sewn, so I just love it. And I did go to Custom Home Furnishings, and I took some classes there. And I, that was, oh gosh, probably about 8 years ago. And I really loved it. And I took, it was actually a headboard class. And we made little headboard samples. It was a weekend course. And I think I made like 6 headboard samples. And I just loved it. And ever since then, I took another upholstery class in St. Petersburg, Florida, because I was living in Florida at the time. And that was an adult education class. And we only went once a week. So it took us forever to finish a project. But I loved it. It was just women would go at night, at the one night, and we could leave our furniture there, so we didn't have to bring it home. And it was just so much fun. And then I moved back to Connecticut, where I'm originally from. And I kept looking all over, where am I going to find more upholstery classes to continue? And I saw one was in New York City, but I was like, oh no, I don't know that I could do that all the time. So then I finally found your site, and then I connected with you and took your classes, and I'm a member, and I absolutely love it. I love it.
That's great to hear. I mean, it's like you were talking about sewing in school. They don't have that option for teenagers anymore, which is really unfortunate because when you start young, it does become part of you and you just keep going.
Oh, it is. I mean, it's amazing. I started sewing in high school, and that was my graduation gift from high school, was my own sewing machine. And my mom and dad also bought me a pair of pinking shears at the time, and my name, my maiden name, is engraved on the scissors, and I still have them in my cabinet, and I just leave them out as a decoration piece. Mm-hmm. But you know, that is just, so I've had these things and it's always been part of my life.
And now you've started turning your passion for upholstery into a part-time career, correct?
Yes. And I've done, I haven't advertised, but I live in a small community here in Connecticut. It's on Long Island Sound, so I walk to the water every night. And there's probably about 1,300 houses out here, and it's very close. Everyone knows everyone or is related to somebody out here. And by word of mouth, I've been able to have numerous clients. I started out with some cushions, and then I just did some draper panels. Now I have a boat cushions to do. So, and I'm kind of liking the variety because it makes it interesting. Yeah. And I try to come home every night after work and do a little bit of sewing. And so it's been fun.
Now, do you do retail to the retail client, or are you working with designers?
No, I'm just doing with the retail client. Mm-hmm. Basically, some of my clients seem to not really know what they want to do. They've come here to my home, so they see what my home looks like, and they're like, oh, I just want my house to look like this. So they're so excited. And then I just talk to them, and everything seems to have been falling into place so far. I have a garage where I have like a big work table like you and Bill have there at the shop. And I'm currently working on getting heat in my garage so that, next year I'll be able to be out in the winter out there.
You'll need that here in New
England. I will. So that's coming. The gentleman already gave me a quote for that. So I'm kind of working towards that. And I have my machines in the house, and, it's a very small house. So it's just a couple steps out to the garage, and you know, it'll be fine. I just, it's right off my kitchen. So I feel like I'm all connected together here. And I like that.
It makes it easy to commute to work, but sometimes it's hard to commute home because you stop wanting to do more, I bet.
I know, but it's just fun to be. Yeah. I'm a homebody, so it works for me. And I don't know, I'm looking forward to it. So, and so far it's been going good.
Now, do you help your clients pick out the fabric? Do you have fabrics that they can choose from, or do you go to fabric stores with them, or how do you
work? No, I do. I have greenhouse fabrics. I've also just recently signed on with another company out of Minneapolis. I don't remember their name, but I have an account. I've also am a direct with SailRight, which has been very good. Mm-hmm. And greenhouse, as well as then, you know, for the frames, I've used Chervan, and let's see, I ordered a couple things from the Big Duck Canvas. So all of those seem to be working for me. And I have, like everyone else, loads of fabric here at my house. So what ended up happening, even for the drapery panels, I suggested this one that I had a bolt of fabric, and it actually worked out. It's just, and the gentleman I did it for, he just loved it. He just thinks it's great. And as a little plus, I just made him a pillow, and you know, so you could put that in that room, and it just worked out. So
I think it's great when you can offer that extra service to your clients so they don't have to go searching for fabrics, because oftentimes our clients don't know what's appropriate for our project. So if you can help them with that, that saves them the headache of a bad choice too. So that's a really good service to offer.
Yes, this gentleman, he just says, no, if you like that fabric, then that'll be fine. You know, so it was just, I don't think he knew where to start.
Yeah. It's hard because there's so much out there to choose from, and it's confusing for the average person that really doesn't understand the usage of the different fabrics. So what is your biggest challenge that you have come across so far? I know you haven't been doing this too long as a business, but what have you found as a challenge for you?
For me, it's time, yeah. You know, and I think a little bit of, I guess I would call motivation to stay focused, to continue. Even though I only do it part-time at night, it ends up that even if I only spend an hour here in my sewing room sewing, the next night I can't wait to come home from work and continue.
Yeah.
So I think that's, before it was always like, okay, I need to do this project and I need to finish it. And I think doing the upholstery, you learn that it's not going to be done. It's not an immediate.
Mm-hmm.
So the continuation, and even if it's only a little bit, it's just satisfying to know that you still have more to do.
It's not over yet. You can do it again tomorrow, right?
Exactly.
Do you use social media for your business?
I have Facebook. That's probably my biggest. I really don't know how to do it. I have a Facebook page, but I don't update it. And I think that's going to be my biggest challenge. Right now, I just don't really know what to do.
Well, you're just starting too, so you don't need to know what to do yet. But I know that a lot of people find social media very useful because people can see your work and they really can get to feel what your personality is by the way you post things and stuff. So I think it's a benefit once you get going. But once you're doing this full time, I'm sure you'll dive right in.
Yeah, it's just that right now I only use Facebook for connecting with you and all the other, you know, people that connect with Kim's DIY Upholstery and with Sandra and all. And now with, I just joined
WCAA.
Yes. And so that's what I use Facebook for. I don't use it for me personally, mm-hmm. because I feel like I don't have any more time in my life between yeah. home, work, trying to do this. That's it. So yeah. It's just strictly for getting my business going.
Yeah.
And learning right now.
What is the favorite part of your business for you? Working with clients, designing, the actual fabrication?
I think the actual fabrication. And currently I, you know, am doing some pillows for a customer. And she brought me this, I hate to say it, but not fabric I would choose to do. But I said, oh, how about if we use this other fabric I had as the welting? And she goes, oh yes, that's wonderful. So I think that allows us to be creative and to put that together. So I think that's kind of the best part of it, to be creative and to actually be satisfied when you produce something.
Because I don't know about you, because we're both in New England, and I find that people in this area don't think outside of the box as much as they do in other parts of the country. So being able to do what you just said you did, is it, you know, suggest an additional fabric for a contrast. People don't think of that themselves. So that's a useful purpose. You know, it's a useful suggestion for them.
Yes.
It helps them be a little more creative.
And I mean, the fabric is, like I said, not something, but we make things and it's not our choice, and that's okay.
Yeah.
And but the thing was, is that I liked the fabric I put on for the welting. So I guess then it was like, okay, I put a little bit of my touch on it. So it's all right.
Yeah. And I was talking with someone the other day about the creative niches that we can all do. And that's one thing I think in this industry that we can help our clients with. And it's not necessarily our taste and our personality, but it's getting them to add something a little bit different and figuring out that niche that you fit in where you can help with that creative aspect.
Yes, that's very true. And even I had done, I had another client who wanted some pillows and I made them and they went off to North Carolina actually. And the client I just saw the other day, and she said the customer my friend that I provided those pillows to just contacted me and said how she loved those pillows. And there's nothing around that are like those. And she said, that's so neat because you go places and everything, it's like we're inundated with so much we can buy. Mm-hmm. But it all just looks the same. And yet when we make something, it's totally custom and you won't find it someplace else.
Exactly. Exactly. There were a few years I know in our industry where, and I love Pottery Barn, so I'm not putting Pottery Barn down, but everybody wanted their homes to look like Pottery Barn. And when you're having custom, you don't have to have it look like everybody else's home.
That's right. That is so true. So true. Yes.
So I know you're planning to be in business full time doing this. Do you see any other growth in your business once you get going? Like moving out of your house or having employees or?
Well, I wouldn't mind having like a little shop where I actually had my upholstery pieces that I would do, maybe do some draperies and do pillows and things like that. And I have a cousin who lives over here by me and she does different flower things and all. And I just think that if, you know, eventually if this could work, maybe we could have a shop together. Once she retires and I retire and we get into it, it might work. And we're still, each time we drive around, we look to see if there's any places. So who knows what'll happen.
So where you're located, is that kind of a touristy area? If you're near the ocean, I'm assuming it might
be.
No,
not really. It's really quite residential. And that's what makes it kind of cool because we don't have a lot of tourists. Mm-hmm. Somebody says it's probably as close to being like on Cape Cod without the industry, kind of a location.
That sounds perfect.
It is. And, you know, I just have a real small home. And but there are homes out here where we are that are in the millions. So it's a wide variety.
Yeah.
But we have a little store and a little pizza place. And that's really about all we have. But that's okay.
That's nice, though. That sounds very quaint and quiet and peaceful.
It is. You know? It is. It's very quaint. And, you know, I live here. I live across the street from the elementary school, so I get to look outside. So if I'm sewing, I'll get up and walk and just look, and the basketball courts are out there, so kids are playing basketball. Mm-hmm. It's kind of neat.
Yeah. Now, do any of your children sew?
I have one daughter. Okay. My daughter's currently an officer in the Navy. She's a dietitian. No, my daughter... I do not know how she's my daughter, but that's...
Isn't that true, though? It's like when we were younger, everybody did what their parents did. You know, if your mother knitted, you learned to knit. If your mother crocheted, you learned to crochet. Your father did woodworking, you were out there helping. And today, it's not like that at all. Our children are like going as far away from what we do as they possibly can in a lot of cases.
I think that, you know, she does not cook. Luckily, her fiance cooks.
She may watch this, so you better be careful.
That's okay. She's a very good sous chef, though. When my husband and I cooked, she used to be a wonderful sous chef. She'd be cutting everything up for us. But cooking, she's not really cooking. And she doesn't, she wouldn't even know how to operate a sewing machine.
And that's not a bad thing. She's got her own thing for sure.
That's right. Yeah. She's in the Navy. She's focusing on what she needs to do. She's in Norfolk, Virginia. So, and that's okay. She's successful. I'm happy for her. So it's good. It is good.
In your sewing world or your upholstery world, what is your favorite thing to do? Whether it's a specific project or a skill or...
What is my favorite thing to do? Well, I'm learning that perfecting is right now my skill I'm working on. You show how you do welting. I'm still, every time I sit down at my machine, I cannot hold it like you do. But I try. Every time I sit down, I try. And I'm like, nope. It's just not working for me. So I purchased, Donna Cash has a video on pillows, mm-hmm. Zippers in pillows, actually. And I signed on for that. And I will say that her method for doing that zipper has been wonderful for me. And I think that trying to perfect even the welting on the pillows, which then works into welting on cushions and all, and it's just amazing. But you do have to, and I'm still working on that, and I think that's my biggest thing right now, is just trying to get everything
to perfect where,
yeah, as perfect as I can be. I know it's never going to be 100% because it's handmade, but I want it to be able to be that good each time I do it.
Right. Now, like you say, you try to hold your hands the same way I do. I show people that, or the students that, but it's like, you can take and watch the way I do something and watch the way somebody else does something and combine the two skills too. I find a lot of times that's better than trying to do it the exact same way somebody does it. You modify it to fit the way your hands function.
Yes, because my hands don't function.
I think the older we get, the less they function, right, sometimes?
Yes. But it's, and I just, actually, I just had a man, found a gentleman who comes out and fixes upholstery machines, who lives only like 2 miles from here. So he came to my house and he worked on my machines for me. And I was like so happy because it had been, years. And so he tuned them all up and he's telling me different things. And I'm like, well, I really didn't know all this about these machines. So I think that we just learn from everybody.
We do. Yeah, I agree with you. And you don't ever stop learning.
And that's what I think is exciting about the whole thing.
Yeah. It's not like a factory job where you're doing the same thing all day long.
No. And, he said, I have my serger, and he's like, oh no, he said, that serger's like a wonderful serger. He said, that'll work fine for all your, cushions and everything like that. And he said, your machines are all in good shape. So, and he's telling me, well, on this machine, you have an awfully big needle. And I'm like, I don't know. I bought the machine used. How do I know what size needle was in there?
You never changed it, I take, huh?
I didn't. And so he, I opened the drawer and I gave him another needle and he put it in and he says, now try this one. What do you think? And I was like, oh my God, the holes are not nearly as large as they were before. So I'm still learning.
Yeah. Now, if you were to start all over again, is there anything you would do different?
Would I do anything different? Well, I don't think so. I haven't had a planned life. No. I actually, the mentor I had in high school, she was a home ec teacher and I had gotten into college, but never went to college, full time out of high school. My first husband was in the military, so I've lived all over the world. It was tough, but now I look back on it and I say, it's okay. I have friends all over. And then, you know, working for the government, I started when I lived in, at one time I lived in Washington, D.C. So that was fine. So I continued my sewing and all. But I don't think I would change anything. Now that I want to transition, I think it's a wonderful opportunity because I don't think I would have ever been a good home ec teacher by any sense of the imagination. I don't have the patience to be a teacher. That's why I only have one child. So that would not have been good for me. And look, we don't even have home ec teachers anymore.
Yeah, unfortunately.
I know, that's kind of sad. So I think it's worked out okay. You know, when I was in, I was in Florida for 17 years, and that's where my second husband, he, we were living there, and he passed away. You know that. And he had a business, and the acronym for his business was MGT. So when I decided I would go into business, I had to fit that acronym into my business. And what name am I going to call myself? And so I read the dictionary for days, looking up all the different letters. So that's how I came up with the marsh grass threads. And it still fits with the MGT. So my husband really pushed me into wanting to have my own business. And, you know, he taught me everything because he had his own business. So I then knew how to do filings and reporting and all that. So that was a godsend. I'm so thankful for that. And so with my name, Marsh Grass Threads, I feel like he's still with me and he's helped me along my way.
That's awesome. That is such, I was wondering where you came up with the name for your business. That is such a great story.
I just had to do that because I thought, oh my God, I've got to come up with the name. And I live by the marsh, by the water. So, and threads is for sewing. So that's how I came up with the name. And yet it's still goes with my husband's MGT business that he had.
That's great. If someone came to you and said, Christa, I'm thinking of starting this business, what can you give me for advice?
I would say yes, definitely do it. I love, even in working at the government, I love mentoring some of the younger employees. And I mean, I'd be happy to help anyone, and I would tell them to do it because it's, yes, it's frightening. To me, it's frightening because I've spent many nights like laying in bed. Oh God, what the heck am I going to do? How am I going to do this? I can't figure this out. But then if you take it one piece at a time, it all ends up working out. And then when you finished it, you're freaking like, oh my God, I did that. That is so wonderful. And I mean, I don't have anybody else to tell that to now other than my dog, but you know, it's okay. I just think about it myself and it's fine. And I feel that's what definitely boosts our confidence. And, you know, we become more of a positive person and we have confidence. And I think we all want that confidence and that's the only way to get it. We can't buy it. We can't, you know, make it. We make it by doing it, but you know, it's not something we can just put on and we'll have it. It's just got to come from within us. And I think that's a big thing.
And I think what you said nails it. It's like people are held back and sometimes don't get started because they're afraid, but just jumping in and making that first step will just, it'll head you down the path and it'll make the rest of the steps easier.
It is. And even when I, when I was thinking about starting Marsh Grass Threads, I went to one of the attorneys. He's actually one of my neighbors. I went over to him and I said, okay, I want to start the business and I'm in a different state. I just wasn't sure. And I said, so I want to do things right, you know? And, so, you know, he just guided me, you know, we spent an hour together and he just, you know, said, just make sure you keep your items for your business separate from your personal items. And he goes, and as if you're, as long as you're trying to do the right thing, he said, it will work out. He said, and if you make a mistake, that's okay, because you've at least tried. He said, but if you don't try, it's not going to work. So just try to do the right thing, keep things separate, you know, and it will work. And so far, what he told me has been working so far.
Yeah, that's great. So this has been really interesting, Christa, hearing a little bit more about your background than I knew before. And I invite you, our members, to go ahead and check Christa out. So where can they find you?
I'm on Facebook at Marsh Grass Threads. And that's, for now, that's it.
But eventually there might be a
website. Eventually there might be more.
Okay. All right. So go ahead and check Christa out on Facebook. I know she's got a few really cute pictures on there of a couple ottomans she did and some dining room chairs and a bed set that I was checking out the other day. And you've got to post some more pictures of some of the headboards. So I know you've done more than what I see on your website.
Oh, yes. Yes. But, I know.
So thanks again, Christa, for sharing your time with us. And thank you to our viewers for watching. I hope you enjoyed this episode. And we'll check back in with Christa and see how she expands once she gets so she's doing this full time.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, Kim.
Thank you.
You've been wonderful for me.
Oh, good. Thank you.
Brought to you by Kim's Upholstery, where we bring the training to you.